surprised about that, because that's not the way we tend to see MFN clauses. MFN clauses are often described in one of two ways. That the MFN clause allows the investor who is operating under the treaty between A and B to bring a claim based on a provision in a treaty between B and C. Now that can't be right. It's an argument that was expressly canvassed by the British and rejected by the International Court of Justice long before MFN clauses became normal in BITs, in the case between Anglo-Iranian, a case involving Anglo-Iranian oil company, after the nationalisation of Anglo-Iranian BP by the Iranian government. Now, the United Kingdom took Iran to the International Court of Justice. It relied on the declarations made by both states accepting the general jurisdiction of the ICJ under the optional clause of the court statute. The problem for Britain was that Iran's declaration ruled out accepting the jurisdiction of the court in relation to disputes under treaties concluded by Iran before it made its optional clause declaration. And the British treaty predated Iran's optional clause declaration. So Britain's argument was to say, well, this treaty of ours has an MFN clause in it. Therefore, we can take advantage of a later treaty between Denmark and Iran, and that will satisfy the Iranian jurisdictional limitation. And the court, by a large majority, including, if I remember rightly, the judge of British nationality, Lord McNair, something which doesn't happen all that often, found against the UK. In order, it said, that the United Kingdom may enjoy the benefit of any treaty concluded by Iran with a third party by virtue of the Most Favoured Nation clause, contained in a treaty concluded by the United Kingdom with Iran, the United Kingdom must be in a position to invoke the later treaty. The treaty containing the Most Favoured Nation clause is the basic treaty upon which the United Kingdom must rely. It is this treaty which establishes the juridical link between the United Kingdom and a third-party treaty, and confers upon that state the rights enjoyed by the third party. A third-party treaty independent of and isolated from the basic treaty cannot produce any legal effect as between the United Kingdom and Iran. It is raised into alias acta. In other words, the British claim had to be based upon its own treaty, and therefore it inevitably fell foul of the Iranian jurisdictional limitation. Now, in some of the investment law textbooks, that is often put forward, that authority, as showing that MFN clauses don't affect jurisdiction. I don't think that that is what the International Court was saying. I think it was saying, for the purposes of interpreting this jurisdictional provision, the one in the Iranian Optional Clause Declaration, that the cause of action of the UK was derived from its own treaty. Therefore, it inevitably fell foul of that jurisdictional limitation. Now, the second way, or the shorthand way of putting it, is to say the effect of an MFN clause is to write into the primary treaty a provision from the secondary treaty. No fair and equitable treatment clause in the primary treaty, but instead you use the MFN clause to write into it the fair and equitable treatment provision from the secondary treaty. But I don't think that's right either. Again, you cannot amend a treaty simply by virtue of an act between one of its parties and a third state. Treaties don't work like that. I think the correct way of looking at the effect of an MFN clause is that it is itself a substantive obligation, a duty of non-discrimination. Therefore, if state B has promised state A that it will treat its investors however those investors are defined in the primary treaty, in accordance with the same standards it applies to investors of third states, and with third states it has concluded treaties which have fair and equitable treatment provisions, the denial of fair and equitable treatment to an investor of state A is a breach of the MFN clause in the primary treaty. In other words, it can't be a breach of the fair and equitable treatment in the clause in the secondary treaty. You merely look to that provision in order to determine whether there has been a breach of the MFN clause in the primary agreement. And it's worth keeping that in mind because it has a substantive effect on the debate I want to turn to, which is MFN clauses and jurisdiction in investor-state arbitration. There is a school of thought that says the offer of investor access to arbitration is itself a key element of the regime for investor protection. If it is offered on more generous terms in one treaty than it is in the primary treaty, the investor under the primary treaty can use the MFN clause, as it were, to piggyback upon the other more generous provision. But it's difficult to reconcile that approach with the way in which an MFN clause takes effect. That's because the investor state arbitration provision is in investor arbitration the offer to arbitrate. It was brilliantly described by Jan Poulsen some years ago in his article Arbitration Without Privity. Although we talk about the BIT being the basis for the tribunal's jurisdiction, strictly speaking, the BIT is an offer to arbitrate. Now, that offer is on the terms set out in the investor state arbitration provision. When the claim is brought against the respondent state, the investor is accepting that offer. And that is the agreement. Not quite clear what is its proper law. F.A. Mann would have had a field day with that if he was still alive. And is probably, even as we speak, writing a piece for the Celestial Law Quarterly Review, analysing this question in trenchant, if not acerbic, terms. But it's that agreement which is the basis for the arbitration tribunal's jurisdiction. Now, looked at like that, it's much more difficult to use an MFN clause to broaden jurisdiction. Sure, you can do it if the MFN clause and the arbitration clause together make it clear that the arbitration clause is not a self-contained offer, but rather an offer which may be modified by some later agreement. Perhaps a bit more difficult to use it for modification by incorporating an earlier agreement, but that's a debate for another day. But if it doesn't make that clear, I find it very difficult to see quite on what basis the MFN clause can simply do the work of the broader arbitration provision. After all, take this possibility. Suppose that the primary treaty contains no provision for investor state arbitration at all, but it does contain an MFN clause, and the respondent state has concluded other treaties with generous investor state arbitration provisions. I have yet to find any suggestion that in those circumstances a claimant can bring an arbitration. But the theory that lies behind the pro-MFN arbitration case law, if you take it to its logical conclusion, would have that effect. You can write in an entire arbitration provision where nothing exists at all. Now, you might be able to do that if the MFN provision is in sufficiently explicit terms, but it would certainly be very brave, and it raises all kinds of difficulties. What happens, for example, when ICSID receives a claim in those terms? Before entering it on the equivalent of the ICJ's general list, the ICSID Secretariat is supposed to satisfy itself that there are at least the basic rudiments of jurisdiction. Well, how would it go about doing that without hearing argument about the effect of the MFN clause? And there is no tribunal to hear that argument. I think a better way of looking at it is to say this, that the MFN clause, if it applies to the investor state arbitration provisions, is a substantive undertaking by state B to the other state party, state A, that it will accord the same access to arbitration to the nationals of state A that it accords to the nationals of other countries. Now, just because it has made that undertaking does not mean to say that the investor state arbitration provision is expanded in that way. It may well be the case that the other state party to the BIT has a claim against state B for not honouring that undertaking. But for the investor, the position is different. The arbitration provision in the primary treaty is the investor's gateway to arbitration in the first place. And I think one has to be a little cautious of assuming that that gateway is automatically broadened just because the state in question has concluded a treaty with an MFN clause in it and then gone in other treaties to grant broader access to investor-state arbitration. Now, looked at that way, we've been asking the wrong question in the recent case law. Instead of asking the question, does the MFN clause apply to investor-state arbitration, we should be asking, does this MFN clause have a particular effect on the investor-state arbitration provision? And it seems to me perfectly possible for a tribunal to conclude that, yes, failing to accord the nationals of state A the same investor-state arbitration facilities that you extend to investors from state C is a breach of the BIT. And yet, nevertheless, to conclude, however, it does not expand the jurisdictional reach of the clause in such a way that the investor can take advantage of that. The breach, in other words, of the substantive provision of the MFN clause is not the same thing as the enlargement of the actual investor-state arbitration provision. The fact that a state should offer greater access to arbitration is not the same thing as saying that it has done so. Now, just to sum up, where then do we come out? Well, the first thing I would suggest very strongly is that we should not talk in terms of the effect of the MFN clause. Instead, we should be looking at MFN clauses in the specific context of the particular treaty in which they are found. And of course, you very often find you have to interpret three different provisions for these purposes. You have to interpret the MFN provision in the primary treaty. You have to interpret whatever provision in another treaty is being invoked to show that there has been a breach of the MFN provision in the primary treaty. And lastly, you may also have to interpret the offer of arbitration, the investor state arbitration provision in the primary treaty. And my view is very strongly that, as the tribunal in Renter 4 put it, there is no alternative to proceeding bit by bit. It's a dreadful pun, but I think the theory behind it is right. Those who prefer the general unified approach will doubtless be more popular with the students. You will probably be more popular with the clients if you usually act for claimants. But nevertheless, I think you're wrong. And I don't think this is a debate between commercial arbitrators and between public international lawyers. I think it is more a matter of the difference between constitutional lawyers and international lawyers. The second difference is that I think it becomes imperative in approaching the relationship between the investor-state arbitration clause and the MFN clause to see how the MFN clause operates as a substantive non-discrimination provision. It would, I think, require more than that, more than simply a general terms MFN clause, to have the kind of effect on broadening jurisdiction that some of the awards have suggested. It might be different, however, if the issue is not jurisdiction, but one of admissibility, because there the investor has already passed through the gateway, or at least through a large part of it. And lastly, everything will depend upon what the express provisions of the primary treaty say. If a state chooses to exclude the effect of the investor-state arbitration clause from the reach of the MFN clause, it's perfectly entitled to do that. At least the two states concerned are perfectly entitled to do that. The CETA-CAFTA approach. On the other hand, if the United Kingdom can persuade other states to sign up to the approach in its bilateral investment treaty, where it expressly provides that investor-state arbitration provisions are covered by the MFN clause, then I think it is much easier to see the investor-state arbitration provision as being broadened. But above all, I would urge a nuanced approach in this, rather than the broad generalisations which in recent years have tended to dominate this area of debate. Thank you all very much.